Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all on behalf of Indian Medical Association on our late Padma Shri Dr. K.K. Agrawal Memorial Lecture. This is our 13th lecture series, and this time we have a very eminent speaker with us, our own Professor Dr. Ved Prakash Mishra. Sir is an, I would say, an eloquent speaker. He is so learned person. It is a treat to listen to him. So I think today's talk is going to be a treat for all of us. And at the end of this whole lecture, I think we are going to learn a lot from him. As the custom goes, I think he really does not need any introduction. But as the custom goes, I have to formally introduce our speaker. Sir is a B.C. Roy National Awardee, and he has also done D.Sc. and he is also diploma M.Sc. from 6 universities. He is the national head of academic program of Indian program UNESCO, and chair in bioethics Haifa, and a member of International Committee for Bioethics for Asia-Pacific region. After reading his biodata, I realized that it is such a huge and long and such, I would say, a very outstanding biodata that if I read everything, I think the whole hour I'll be just introducing him. So I'm going to introduce him in very short. So, sir, pardon me if some important points have been left. But I think you yourself, your space explains everything, how learned and eloquent speaker you are. So he is also a pro-chancellor in Datta Mega Institute of Medical Sciences. And he's a chief advisor to Honorable Chancellor and Krishna Institute of Medical Sciences. He is also an advisor of Human Ethics Committee Association in Bangalore and is a dean of Academic and Accreditation Board of National Indian Medical Association, New Delhi. Means that's our own. Honorary Director, Center for Health Sciences and Education Policy and Planning. Former Chairman, Postgraduate Medical Education Committee, Medical Council of India, New Delhi. And he's also a former Chancellor of Krishna Institute of Medical Sciences and a former Chairman of Academic Council of Medical Council of India, that is MCI. So, sir, I think this is the shortest I could do. And I know if I go on and on, but I think everybody wants to listen to you. So today's topic is COVID-19 vaccine generation and distribution, ethical dilemmas there too. So after this much of COVID pandemic, it's nearly been a 1.5 year of this COVID pandemic and vaccinations going on full throttle all over India. But still, there are so many dilemmas in our minds also, which vaccine to use, when to use, whether cocktails are good or not, whether you really need a third booster dose. So there's so many things we really need to know. And so here is our eminent speaker, Dr. Ved Prakash, to enlighten us. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mona. I'm really obliged for your kind, good, liberal words. Thank you very much. Learned National President IMA, my esteemed brother, Dr. Jailal. Learned Honorary Secretary General of IMA, Dr. Jayesh Lele. All the learned IMA office bearers, past office bearers, and all those who are participating virtually for this late Padma Shri Dr. K.K. Agrawal Memorial Lecture. At the outset, as a part of my bounden duty and with fullest sense of gratitude and thankfulness, I would like to pay my humble homage to my learned younger brother and a doyen of health sciences in this country, late Dr. K.K. Agrawal, in terms of whose contribution and whose consistent contribution, rightly, the Indian Medical Association has ventured upon this entire lecture series. And in my humble opinion, there could not have been a better tribute that could have been paid to the departed glorious soul, because this is exactly what he lived for, and this was exactly his passion and commitment which he dispensed all his life. Corona period and his videos, perhaps they were so made for each other that if at all a single man responsible for the single-handed generation of awareness on such a vital count is required to be attributed, perhaps, ladies and gentlemen, all of us will agree that he was none other than our esteemed brother and prestige of IMA, an illustrious former HSG and former national president of IMA, Padmashri late Dr. K.K. Agarwal. Therefore, paying these glorious tributes, and in continuation of the very tradition which has been set in by him, I am wanting to dwell on a significant aspect which very rightly put in by Dr. Mona is baffling us day in and day out in regard to the various ethical dilemmas that we are plagued to. The topic or the theme is huge, but I am taking two cardinal aspects for the purposes of depiction of what I am wanting to put across. Number one, when we are talking of a pandemic like COVID-19, the only succor that mankind could have had was a vaccine, and therefore the mass vaccination thereof. Therefore, in tune with that, vaccination turns out to be a real repository in any situation of pandemic as we are being plagued with. But then, there are two important aspects which I am wanting to put across. Generation of vaccine, and having generated the vaccine, distribution of vaccine. Now, basically, if you look into this essence of human history, why I am raising these poses, not out of an imaginative fiction. There is a sound rationale in which we are required to be peeping into certain pages of historicity. It was Second World War, atrocities, human damage there too, prisoners of war and prisoners of war being so badly availed for various biological purposes that mandated mankind to evolve in the interest of men, mankind, humanity, and humanism, a key charter adopted by all the nations which we fondly know and rightly know as UNO Charter, United Nations Organization Charter, which basically revolved around two important cardinal values, ladies and gentlemen, and that was human respect and human dignity. These are the two considerations which basically make you and me feel that we are not only civilized, but we are of barbarism. Having gone a long way, it's not only the civility, it is the prudence in the society which is expected to be making a civilized society get converted into a humanistic egalitarian society. And that is possible only when two cardinal values in terms of human respect at one end, blended with human dignity at the other, they are ushered in as golden rules to be upheld come what may at all costs. This was the national, international consensus that was worked up in the name of UNO Charter. Ladies and gentlemen, I would also like to remind you of the second important key document which came to be generated out of similar international deliberation, and that was Helsinki Declaration. Helsinki Declaration basically is what, ladies and gentlemen? Biomedical research that have been carried out and that will be required to be carried out in the interest of men and mankind. What will be the nature of those researches? What will be the ethical considerations of those researches? What will be the ethical and value-based mandate which will be governing all of them? And therefore, we charted out a path for our own biomedical research, which is called as Helsinki Declaration. And therefore, I am wanting to correlate the UNO Charter of Human Dignity and Human Respect with the Helsinki Charter, which has been adopted by all the countries, including the ICMR guidelines on biomedical research, is nothing but it's a wee but a reflection and incorporation of Helsinki Declaration, which is binding to the entire world on biomedical research. The third important document which I am wanting to be interpolating is, having taken up human dignity to Helsinki Declaration in 2005, UNESCO worked out yet another important declaration, which we call as UNESCO Declaration on Bioethics, on a generated triangle that whenever we are contemplating human welfare, that welfare has to be within the tenets of ethicality at one end, morality at the second end, and value ethos at the third end. This is the triangle in which be it medical care, be it medical profession, be it medical, biomedical research, all that we contemplate as a succor for the interest of men, mankind, and human welfare, it has to be within the tenets of the important cardinal considerations being upheld, namely the ethicality at one end, morality at the other, unified by the third dimension that we call as value basis and value ethos. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, what I'm wanting to put across is no pandemic of any type, howsoever huge magnitude it be, howsoever huge substantial damage it may cause, the material question is, are we entitled to be shunning and are we entitled to be bypassing what we have evolved as a human charter to our own self is the first consideration against which these two important aspects need to be covered. No doubt, whenever we are talking of such a huge multitude of human loss and the terror which is caused because of the pandemic, a material question which always agitates our mind is, it is the public good which is important. And therefore, the first ethical dilemma with which all of us plagued by is whether, in the name of public good, can the individual good, in terms of his or her rights, they be sacrificed, is a million-dollar question. Are the public good interests so paramount that individual good, individual liberties, individual rights, or for that matter, individual privileges can be sacrificed? And it is in this balancing of public health good versus individual rights, this is the balancing act which would turn out to be the key edifice when I am wanting to take this theme up for consideration. Ladies and gentlemen, when you talk of generation of COVID-19 vaccine, I will be dealing four important aspects there too. Number one, availing of the fetal cell line that we contemplate as a step one. Number two, the direct human challenge trial that has been resorted to. Number three, what has happened to the placebo control trial, which otherwise was mandated, and therefore finally having generated the vaccine, are we really in a position to go in for distribution of the vaccine in accordance with the ethical and governing principles which we have evolved for ourselves? Therefore, it is in these four dimensions I would like to be taking this up for the purposes of information. The first is generation of the vaccine and use of fetal cell lines. I am not going in for historicity of fetal cell lines, the use, the utility, the importance. That all is a matter of record. Experts can deliberate on it. I have a single poser which I put to myself. Is it not a fact that anti-abortion groups all over the world have come across with an ethical declaration that fetal cell lines generated out of any induced human abortion, it will mean that such a usage by whatever group of people in whatever name, it will amount to users are complicit to induction of the said abortion. Now, this is an ethical dilemma which I am wanting to put across. It may not be a rule, and I am already putting it across. When we talk of the ethical conduct, when we talk of the value ethos, their enforceability is not in terms of the legislative enactment. They are moral rules. They are worked out for the purposes of invocation of prudence in the human minds, and therefore the sanctity thereof may not be taken up in letter. The sanctity thereof is more paramount in the spirit rather than the letter. And therefore the consideration of the anti-abortion group advocacy pertaining to impermissible use of cellular lines in the name of whatever good that we are contemplating still turns out to be a human ethical dilemma which has remained unanswered. We have availed cell lines for the purposes of invocation of COVID-19 vaccine. That is a matter of reality, without really catering to as to whether this particular resolution in terms of dilemma is resolvable or not. That is the poser which still is looming large on you or in my head, and the answer evoke or answers evade even as of now. Forget it. I'm straightway coming to the second important parable, which is more important than any other consideration, ladies and gentlemen. And that is, you are talking of directly human challenge trials. If you take any vaccine generation in the past, not that this was the first pandemic where we were required to be generating a vaccine of its own type. There have been umpteen occasions where the vaccines came to be generated.
And we all of us know that the guidelines for the purposes of generation of the vaccine put across by WHO itself, they are the various steps which are defined. And therefore, in the present situation, of course, we can understand the steps that have been stipulated and the nature of the production or the generation that is contemplated in accordance with the said guidelines. It is time consuming because there are several stages in terms of the required extent of coverage and ambit which is necessary for it, which in the present juncture had to be compromised is an advocacy, but was realistically compromised is a matter of reality. And therefore, the second important consideration, which I'm wanting to be putting across in the context of generation of the vaccine, is compromise in terms of, in the name of duration, in the name of urgency, the vital steps which were mandated, the vital coverages which were mandated, which were called for, in terms of the guidelines which we have evolved for ourselves, had to be given a go by is one advocacy, but realistically they have been given a go by is a matter of reality. And therefore, in that context, what are the concerns which I am wanting to raise? Number one, it is agreed that when we are talking of human challenge trial directly, there are three distinct advantages that we evoke for ourselves. Number one, it needed fewer volunteers as compared to the natural invocation, which would have resulted in involvement of a larger number of human volunteers. Therefore, with lesser number of human volunteers, this particular undertaking was feasible. Number two, as a result of which the cost entailed in the generation of the vaccine definitely has come down to a substantial level because of the lesser number of the required recruitment of the volunteers and therefore the reduction of the cost. And the third most important part was taking into consideration the urgency, the nature, the duration compromise which was mandated could be achieved by virtue of this. Therefore, it is the time boundedness and shortening of the duration which has been invoked in the present context. It is this trinity of so-called advantage that the compromises are advocated to be permissible. But yet, ladies and gentlemen, there are certain posers which definitely turn out in the context of, if you look into Helsinki Declaration, biomedical research, what is the mandatory thumb rule that we invoked on there? We said, whenever we will be taking the biomedical research for any human purpose, it is imperative that it will be worked out on the principle of minimum impact or minimum risk to the participants who will be putting themselves as volunteers. The most important part is minimum risk. Let us identify as to whether this particular principle was feasible and was practicably evolved and implemented or not. You will realize for yourself, you take any generation of any vaccine in any trial in this country, the fact of the story is, instead of the minimum risk part, which was the binding principle, the volunteers were subjected to the maximum risk. And then what will happen to the informed consent, I will come a bit later. Therefore, the breach of the principle was that whenever you will be availing the human subjects for the purposes of working out an invocation, the subjects have to be subjected to minimum risk. And what do you mean by minimum risk? Whenever we are talking of the minimum risk, it is imperative that there must be two important declarations, ladies and gentlemen. One, what is the accepted line of treatment? I am not saying standard protocol. I am not saying the binding and finalized protocol. What is the accepted line of treatment? Because when you are talking of vaccination and when you are availing human subjects for the purposes of human challenge trial, we are infecting the virus in the person and we are making him sick or her sick for the purposes of invocation of the immune response and usage thereof. Ladies and gentlemen, minimum risk coverage in terms of the guidelines mandated that it would be imperative that you will never recruit human volunteers for any human challenge trial without declaring as to what the accepted treatment would be for the particular subject. And not only that, that accepted treatment has to be a part of what is called in the guidelines as pre-request accepted treatment. before I make a request to human volunteers for participation, what is mandatory, that what should be in my hand? I should be having pre-requested, accepted line of treatment, which has been worked out. I am drawing your attention, ladies and gentlemen, to a declaration which was made by WHO on 6th of May. And what was that declaration designated as? I am wanting your attention to be right to be taken to that declaration pertaining to key criteria for ethical acceptability of COVID-19 human research trial. Critically look into those guidelines. There are several clauses which are similar to hitherto ones in tune with the Helsinki Declaration. But when we say that the key criteria in accordance with the ethical principles have been declared as early as 6th of May 6, 2020, there was no indication of any accepted line of treatment on COVID in the said document. And therefore, it is after these guidelines which came into operation, the recruitment of human volunteers took place in absence of any accepted line of treatment. And therefore, I am wanting to correlate with how exactly the principle of minimization of risk is to be weighed in the context of ethical declaration on COVID vaccination generation by WHO on 6th of May 2020 without even remotely indicating as to what would be the accepted line of treatment. It is not included, ladies and gentlemen. And even till date, we are vaccinating people, we are availing vaccines, but what is the accepted line of treatment across the world and what is the official declaration thereon even today is missing. Therefore, that is another important landmark dilemma which I am wanting to be bringing across. Ladies and gentlemen, again, I am wanting to put across. Similar situations did we not work out in terms of availing vaccines for the important diseases like malaria, cholera, and typhoid? These are the examples. Until and unless the accepted line of treatment were declared, there was no undertaking which was worked out on that particular count. But here there was a deviation. Again, I am saying, I am not arguing. Please take me as a devil's advocate. I am not wanting to minimize down the importance of it being generated in a timely manner. Please do not misunderstand me. I am just wanting to bring across there are certain substantial ethical dilemmas which are lit large on the face of it, and maybe we will have to work out answers thereon. If we blink our eyes and turn our eyes off that, perhaps these yawning gaps and gray areas will remain unanswered. And the quest that we intend to have on these counts, it will remain absolutely under the carpet. And that is the precise reason why I'm wanting to flag these issues with whatever understanding I have at my disposal. Having said so, ladies and gentlemen, imagine recruiting volunteers for the purposes of human challenge trial, knowing fully well that there is no accepted line of treatment. The exposure will be to the maximization of risk. What is the operational reality? You take any vaccination which has been worked out anywhere in the world by any country, in any name, in any trial, human challenge trial, the recruitment of volunteers, it invariably has been by inducement. And the inducement has to be viewed in the context of two important factors, ladies and gentlemen. In the entire developed world, you ascertain the socio-economic status of the volunteers who have been availed in human challenge trial. The volunteers who have been availed, fortunately, in terms of the depiction, brings out that they have been recruited from lowest of the socio-economic considerations. We talk of human dignity. We talk of human prestige. We talk of human esteem. We talk of human respect. We talk of autonomy. We talk of responsibility. We talk of responsiveness. We talk of beneficence. We talk of non-beneficence. All this strong talk. Where exactly it gets hidden when the entire recruitment of the volunteers across the developed world that turns out to be a matter of reality being recruited from the lowest socio-economic considerations and group, which speaks that perhaps the inducement was not only in terms of payments, but the inducement was identification of those who otherwise would be seeking keenly the inducements which were available or which were put across. This is the important human ethical dilemma which I am wanting to focus. As if this is not enough, ladies and gentlemen, I am yet across wanting to bring yet another important aspect. A pandemic of this magnitude, it virtually inundates the economy. And therefore, the fragility of the social determinants and the socio-economic situation, by virtue of the absolute disruption of the economy, the future is also put into peril. If you and me feel threatened, imagine what must be the plight of that poorest of the poor, weakest of the weak, and remotest of the remote in these counts. And therefore, the economic depression and the economic onslaught generated as a result of the pandemic turns out to be one of the key considerations of alluring and luring those poorest of the poor to be availing this opportunity of submitting themselves to as a human volunteer for the human challenge trial. And in this context, ladies and gentlemen, then I bring you to an important consideration. Leave aside, this could also be a matter of interpretation, but is it possible for you and me to be recruiting any person in the human challenge trial without conforming to the requirements of informed consent? What is the nature of the informed consent which has been procured? On paper, it may be gigantic. But in reality, the compulsions in which the informed consent is procured is basically not only on a weak footing, but it stands on a wicked footing. And therefore, the entire principle, quote unquote, of the informed consent has been put into peril in a huge way, and which is lit large on the face of it. And ladies and gentlemen, yet another important aspect which needs to be focused. Is it not a fact that generation of vaccine, for the first time we saw in the history that practically everybody was running for the generation of a vaccine? I am yet to come across such a competition of generation of the vaccine. Who first? And a rat race for generation of the vaccine. I'm all for it. But then we ourselves have evolved a principle of equipoise. And that principle of equipoise is what? Once one vaccine has been proved to be effective and has been declared to be effective, then there is no need of any further discovery, invention, and formulation of vaccine. This is the principle of equipoise. Look into the declaration that we have evoked in terms of 1962 Helsinki Declaration. What has happened to the principle of equipoise? Practically everybody. And now we are not only, and as rightly put in by Dr. Mona, that we are not only talking of vaccination, we are talking of hybridization of vaccine. Ki tumhari bhi laga lo, meri bhi laga lo, dono ki nahi lage to kisi teesre ki laga lo, as if it is a free market for vaccination, which humanity never knew. The reason is not multiplicity of vaccination, ladies and gentlemen. The reason and substantiation which I am wanting to put across is that under each of these vaccination, there is a human challenge trial which was avoidable on the principle of equipoise. But because vaccination became a weaponry, it became an armory for the countries to think that this is one weapon by virtue of which the sagging economy as a result of the onslaught would be a huge modality for the coverage, and therefore the complexity of human trials and the multiplicity of vaccination. It is this loss of principle of equipoise which ultimately turns out to be a very important, significant aspect. And what is the justification which has been put across? The justification is very simple. They say, ultimately, it is the sacrifice of the few which is required to be taking care of the many. My question is not sacrifice of the few. My question is sacrifice of the which few? We have been talking about the equal world. We have been talking about the equal humans. We have been talking about equity, equality, and equitability. Then in that situation, is it mandatory that the mundane mortals alone will be sacrificing themselves for the purposes of submitting in whatever compulsion to the human challenge trial in absence of any standard treatment available, taking maximum risk in the name of informed consent, giving a compulsory forced consent, and ultimately then also being declared that sacrifice of the few is mandatory for the survival of many? Again, this question, something, it is a slur on the concept of humanism which we harbor with so much of grace, honor, and dignity. And therefore, this is something which will have to be answered. Is it compulsory on part of the particular set of the people plagued by iniquity, plagued by poverty, plagued by ignorance, played by socio-economic considerations, plagued by impoverished social determinants, will they always be invariably used as the easiest of the prey? Are they expected to be human beings, or they are expected to be the guinea pigs for the purposes of catering to your and my cause is again a million-dollar question which the humanity and humanism will be required to be answering. After one success, relevance of all other trials was redundant. They should have been stopped then and there. On the contrary, there was a competition for recruitment, and not only recruitment, recruitment in a liberal way, so that the duration came to be curtailed without even placebo trials of any type. And this is exactly what has happened in the present situation. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, what I'm wanting to advocate is, at one end, we are talking of right to medical care, health for all by 2018, where the people who were subjected to human trial, were they not entitled to right to medical care? And when you are talking of right to medical care, are the professionals like you and me not equally bound by the governing principle of duty that we own for the purposes of extending of the care which is accruable to the individual in the name of right to health care? What happens? And COVID-19 vaccination, ladies and gentlemen, let me with all humility put across the learned people listening to me, a new huge debate in this world. And that is ethics which govern you and me as a physician. The ethical principles that are so bounden to me when it comes to your and my duty as extending the legitimate health care. But they say the moment we become researchers, we are governed by a different code of conduct. Means when I am Jekyll, I will be with a different code. And when I become Hyde, I will be with a different code. This is something which is difficult for me to understand, in as much as today we are required to be believing and coming down to be forcing, being forced to a situation whereby we are required to take this, that there will be two sets of ethics, in as much as ethics when I will be working as a researcher, it will be a different set. And when I am there as a clinician, it will be a different set. Meaning thereby, please try to understand what is the advocacy underlining it. The advocacy is simple, that when I am a physician, when I am a clinician, then in that situation, the person's right to care is extendable by me as a part of my duty. But when I'm availing the same healthy person, please mind well, volunteers are not unhealthy people. Volunteers are healthy person. But when I am availing a healthy person, for the purposes of he or she being a volunteer to my biomedical research, my ethic as a clinician does not entitle me to guarantee right to medical care to him. And this is the justification which is being advocated, in the sense that in absence of the standard declared treatment in case of COVID, human recruitment is permissible. And a way out is being found, that the need is imperative, that we need to work out a subtle distinction between two important things. One, ethics governing the clinical practice, and ethics governing the same clinical clinician when he is a researcher. There will be a separate set of ethics. There are people who are advocating this controversy both for and against. I am not dragging you into that. It is an ongoing controversy. Good number of publications, including in BMJ and Lancet, have come into it. A recent article in BMJ advocating such a segregation is published across. Therefore, I mean, this is also one important aspect which we cannot lose sight of, and hence, can ethics of clinician in his altered role as biomedical researcher could be different when it comes to important right of an individual to health care? According to me, my little understanding and whatever little bioethics principles I've been able to follow, individual health care right is absolutely absolute in nature. Look into UNO declaration, look into UND declaration, look into bioethics declaration, look into Helsinki declaration, and for that matter, look into sustainable goals that you and me have evolved. Look into Para 17 and the Charter 17 of sustainable goals. What has happened to all that? Are we willing to go by to all these situations in the name that no, now we are realizing that in the given situation, there will be two sets of ethical code of conduct? I think perhaps things are being stretched too far, and therefore a midway is required to be found out, because men cannot be put to sacrilege and sacrifice. Whatever their compulsions be, life is absolute, and therefore that absolute life is required to be respected absolutely. It cannot be availed in the form of guinea pigs. It should not be availed in the form of guinea pigs. Only a defense in the name of informed consent is too weak a defense, which is neither tenable nor it is sustainable whenever it will be coming to a situation of critical evaluation. Ladies and gentlemen, there may be legality in it. I don't deny that. But what I'm wanting to advocate before this erudite gathering is 5,000 years before, Socrates made a statement. And what was that statement? I am tempted to quote. I am wanting this entire talk of mine to be put across within the quote and unquote frame what Socrates put it as. He said, what is ethically wrong cannot be legally correct and cannot be legally just and politically correct, unquote. Again, I am repeating, ladies and gentlemen. He says, what is ethically wrong? It cannot be legally just and it cannot be politically correct. He was questioned on this. And then to that extent, what he replied, ladies and gentlemen, is something which should be a torch bearer and not an eye opener for us. Socrates very categorically said, when I am saying this, I know it for certain. And my dictum would be a right, even if nobody practices, and a wrong, if everybody practices, does not become a right. It is this differentiation, ladies and gentlemen, which I am wanting to put across. I may be knowing what I am trying to put across is something which is surmountable. Even the crisis is so huge. Where are you talking all this? But then there are occasions where we are required to take note of this, not because we are burdened and we are put under the yoke, but they let there the conscience prevail. These are the poses which we will be required to be answering, which we will be required to be discussing, and which will be required to be bringing out pragmatic solutions thereon. It is, today we may be blinking the eyes, but these blinking of the eyes of ours cannot be converted into be turning blindfolded to this. World has paid heavy prices on this count. And that was the reason why the conducts and why the courts came to evolve. I can understand. If the time is this where we are required to be having a rule look at the entire encryption of the same, I have nothing against. I will be one of the proponents of it. But until and unless we flag up the issues, where exactly the things stand compromised? Maybe we may be having our own justifications. That is not the point which I am wanting to put across. Deviations, distortions, marginalizations. The time does not become far when they turn out to be pollutants and end up in perversions. This is the natural situation of the human history which takes place. We need to be alerted on that particular count. And therefore, when we talk of the generation, these are the four or five important principles. Principle of equipoise, principle of equity, principle of absolute healthcare versus public good, principle of differential ethics vis-a-vis the healthcare researcher and the clinician, and most important part is human challenge trial in the name of availing the poorest segments of the society, in the name of informed consent, more so plagued by compulsions of the situation. How exactly this needs to be rated turns out to be again a human dilemma, which needs to be taken up for the purposes of its consideration on all counts. Having said so, ladies and gentlemen, there are many other things, but within 1 hour, I am required to be touching all the flag points, and therefore I will be taking up the second consideration. Now we are through multiplicity of vaccines, and perhaps now a time has come when people will be picking up a loudspeaker and saying, unki mat lo, meri le lo. This is the situation which is going to prevail in the present situation. You will be coming across now agents. You will be coming across now people. You will be coming across touts who will be narrating how the other vaccine is bad and my vaccine is good, which has never happened before. Never we got an opportunity of criticizing any vaccine, because vaccine was pure, precise and perfect. We are living into the arena of perhaps, again, I'm telling you, pardon me for saying this. I am not saying imperfect vaccine. I am saying vaccines which otherwise are in search of perfection. In such vaccines in search of perfection, all of them vying for perception, not yet declaring that they are perfect. Then you tell me, are we expected to be imperfect, to be taking up vaccines which are there in the quest for perfection. This is again a human dilemma which is wanting to be taken into its own stride. Having said so, let us come to the distribution. We are all talking about one world. We are all talking of humanism and humanistic world. I would like you to remind that on 22nd November 2020, G20, topest leaders of G20 group, the most elite, powerful group of the world, they met and they made a declaration that vaccination is expected to be a hallmark of global public good. And ladies and gentlemen, I would like to bring to your knowledge that this declaration was made on two important documents I'm having in my hand. And what was that document? They say that we have evolved what is called as fair priority model. Fair priority model is something which has been evoked as a part of G20 declaration. And what is fair priority model? Fair priority model means vaccines to be availed on the basis of countries on three important considerations. And I'm narrating it to you. Number one, their capacities to provide care. One who will be having lesser priority to provide for care will be a matter of priority for pickup. Number one, their ability to distribute vaccines, disbursement. Number three, whether they have, now see the clever part of it, whether they have help in testing and developing these new interventions. Now see the catch which I'm wanting to put across. Or if I was strong enough, if I was having capacity enough, then I would not have waited for you to be generating things for me and me to be waiting it in charity. If I am in the most need, if my incapacitation is strongest, where is the capacity of mine to be participating into that game, which means, please now read in between the lines. What is contemplated is that if you cannot provide anything, you provide us human guinea pig volunteers that will be taken as your participation. And on the strength of your participation, this is something which you will be getting in return. The first two guidelines read with the third guideline, it brings out what it ought to be. And therefore, what I'm wanting to hint is, ladies and gentlemen, a weak catering to the cause of strong, a poor catering to the cause of rich, a Bible catering to the cause of capacity to buy wala in the name of being bought. If this is the barter's ethics in the world, I have nothing to say. But if world has come out from this, and in reality it has come out, what has been said in the third wave by Alvin Toffler, the basic difference between barbarism, civility to prudent man and mankind evolution has been that we all started with a dictum. Might was right. Where might was right, it was a barbaric society. Now today, when we call ourselves civilized, civil, prudent world, might is not right. Right is might. Now if right is might, then are we returning back to those situations where mighty will be in a position to snatch away the right of the weakest ones and then again say that because this was viable, therefore it was bought, and therefore the cause of the larger good has been catered to. Is this the reverse? Is this not the reversal of the situation, which is reversing the clock back to 180 degrees where we started from? Are we therefore not into the clutches where perhaps in the name of compulsions, we will be back to a barbaric situation which perhaps will not be something which will be conducive and acceptable? It is in that context, ladies and gentlemen. I am wanting to put across the seven important considerations which were put across by Dr. David Navarro, World Health Organization Special Envoy for COVID-19 and United Nations, brought out, publicly declared seven important considerations in regard to distribution. Number one, put vaccines where they will do the most good. Absolutely fine. Where it will do the most good, that is to be put into place. Health workers to be the first responders on prioritization. Worldwide acceptable. Prioritize those with prefixing conditions in terms of morbidities. Absolutely fine. Those over 65 years should be put into first line. Absolutely fine. Now important. All this is specifically specific. Now I am coming to specific but availed non-specifically. Is it not a fact that in this charter, we are saying poverty reduction as a criteria, vaccine to be put as a priority, where the damage that will be caused to the economy as a result of existing priority, adding as a vicious circle to further augmentation of the same, that will be a criteria on the basis of which a preference is to be made. It is not only that, where you will be in a position to go in for reduction of the transmission rate, where the rate of transmission is high because of the population density, and you will be in a position to make an intervention onto that particular transmission, that will be your area of preference. Where you will be in a position to go in for prevention of disability, that will be your area of preference. And in the way you are, your aim will be where maximum life years are going to be saved. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm just putting one question because I have not been able to answer it to myself. I looked at all these important seven cardinal principles which have been brought out by WHO, to which 192 countries are signatory, whether they have been observed in breach or they have been observed in observance is again a $1 million question which I'm putting to. And therefore, I am tempted to only conclude, maybe at this juncture unilaterally, that they have been observed more in breach and hardly in real sense. Leave aside at some places, even in letter, but the spirit in which that has been drafted absolutely stands inundated. It is in this context, ladies and gentlemen. When we are talking about the distribution also, the distribution is lopsided. We have said that at least if 20% of the population a country is wanting to be availing on its own, remaining can be worked up. No computation thereof has come into public domain so far. What has happened to that principle is a $1 million question. Nobody knows it. And when it is going to come, absolutely unpredictable. Therefore, there are n number of mysteries which are there under the wrap. We need to take note of it. You and me as scientific community, you and me as professionals, you and me as part of the largest national medical association of the world, we need to look towards all these situations dispassionately. And that was the reason why in the name of Dr. K.K. Agarwal, as a part of obeisance to him and to his departed soul, I requested Dr. Jayalal to permit me to be speaking onto this particular theme in all its socio, political and policy dimensions, especially in the context of ethical considerations that we have evolved over a period of time. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, in regard to generation and distribution, I am not touching minor consideration. I am flagging 6 cardinal principles which we evoke for ourselves and which we find in the given situation, they don't seem to be getting aligned with this entire process, only in the consideration. This does not entitle you and me to conclude that public good is sacrificable. No, public good is not sacrificable. Public good is paramount, but public good will always be required to be balanced with the individual good, because no individual can be taken to be a lesser mortal and can be availed as a sacrificial goat in the name of larger good. And if that sacrifice is expected to be committedly put on just because he or she belongs to a helpless class of society, then in that situation, it is more of a slur than of a reality, which is expected to be a real situation of the present malady that we are subjected to. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, it is with these observations, maybe there are still more yawning gaps and more yawning areas which are gray in character, which may be haunting us. But whatever little on the cardinal principles I was able to flag in, within the permissibility of time constraint I was able to put into, I have tried to venture it to stitch it as best as possible. I know it for certain. The list is open-ended. And your request is far more open-ended on that. But yes, my venture was to flag these issues, not for the purpose of making you believe that we will be having solutions. But yes, when mind agitates and when mind provokes, intellect yields. And when intellect yields passionately for a dispassionate sense in a larger essence, then it is not the better which gets generated. What stands generated is even better than the best and worthier than the worthiest. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, it was a really thought-provoking talk. And what you have told has, I think, disgusted all of us that what has been done. This vaccination, though they said that it was an emergency, and you are quite true, that whatever is unethical cannot be proved legally just because that was an emergency and pandemic. And you are quite true, the vaccines given to us are not been properly, or I would say, tested, because usually every vaccine we take, as being a pediatrician, I know it takes 8 to 10 years for it to come into a market. And here it was fast-tracked within a year. So you are quite right that we have not gone through the minor details, which I think it is our right to know. But, sir, I think it is really thought-provoking. What do you suggest now? What should be done to just improve the situation?
See, look, first thing is we must be fair and honest in as much as bringing out a white paper on generation of vaccines, which will be for the entire world community to know. See, transparency of information is expected to be a hallmark in the present situation. And therefore, it is not a memoir that generations after us will be looking into it and digging into the documentation and working out solutions. Let our sincerity bring out a white paper on generation of vaccination and distribution thereof dispassionately. If we can have international groups working on various aspects, why should there not be an international group working on generation of a white paper on generation of COVID-19 vaccines in the world and distribution thereto? Plagued by limitations, one, operational limitations, two, and finally, disbursement, three. On these three counts, if a white paper is brought out, I think it will be a factual picture which will be in a position to be giving us a real insight into all these situations. Compulsions of the situation, Dr. Mona, are understandable by each one of us. We are not wanting to dissect open a situation with any ulterior motive. But then, whatever happens, let that happening be looked dispassionately for the purpose of bringing out something more vital so that we are equipped with a greater degree of care, caution, resulting into a fair degree of ease and elegance.
Right, sir. Sir, we have Professor Partha. I think he has raised his hand. He wants to ask some question. Yes, sir.
Professor Mishra, namaskar from Liverpool. And thanks to Dr. Desai for giving me the opportunity and to IMA headquarters. I must congratulate you, Professor Mishra, for raising the issue of bioethics, which is not taught in my days, and I'm not sure if it's part of the NMC undergraduate or even postgraduate medical curriculum, because all of this that you discussed, which was brilliant and very, very relevant to our present day and times, including for the largest doctors organization in the whole world, we must have either classes in bioethics or we must have either, you know, curriculum. So bioethics is so important, and you impacted, use the COVID template, the vaccine development, to point out where the gaps in this pandemic have showed us, where we have been ethically perhaps short in delivering our activities of vaccine development. The standards of clinical care and research methodology, and I'm both a clinician researcher, and I wish to have more of research activities when I go back to India, and that needs to be developed. So there are standard guidelines, good clinical practice guidelines, research guidelines. If we ensure that there is strict adherence to all this, then do not think all this will be taken care of to some extent, although basically we must all be educated and understand what the ethics principles are. That's my first question to you, Professor Mishra, about incorporating this and the standards of clinical and research care.
Thank you very much. I think there could not have been a better pertinent poser than what you have really put across. I will take up your query first. In all humility, let me subject it that having been vested with the responsibility as chairman of the then Medical Council of India, the Academic Council of Medical Council of India, the competency-based medical education, which has been put into operation in the country from 2019 across the country in 581 medical schools, it includes complete ATCOM module with 57 competencies, 140 hours of teaching spread over 4 years of teaching on where ATCOM is, where A stands for attitude, ET stands for ethics, and COM stands for communication. So the entire cognitive or the affective domain of the curriculum is not only well structured, it has been put into competencies, it has been put into assessment mode, it has been placed into various levels of first MBBS, second MBBS, part 1 MBBS, and final MBBS, and it has been put into assessment as well. And now the alignment of the same with the postgraduate and super specialty medical education is already under the task, under the work being worked out by a special experts group, and maybe within 6 months, we will be through with it. So the first part is already taken care of. Coming to the second part, you're very right. See, please try to understand clinical. See, the whole problem is not that the clinical practicing guidelines are at any loggerheads with the binding research guidelines. In the present situation, what has happened is because there are certain compulsions of the situation, and those compulsions of the situations are directly availing the human challenge trial, and that human challenge trial being worked out in absence of, as I classically say, I'm not saying standard protocol, even a radical treatment or a declared line of treatment that in case the subject is getting the disease, here is a remedy which is available, which should be taking recourse to, or any sequelae thereof, it will be taken care of. This is a primary assurance in terms of a public declaration duly brought out into the ethical guidelines governing the biomedical research for the vaccination, which has been done by the WHO. On 6th of May 2020, but that particular part of available standard treatment has been given a go by. So therefore, it is not two guidelines strictly added to, sir, they will be totally complementary. We will never be put into a situation as to whether the guidelines in my clinical practice, they will be materially different than the guidelines which will be governing me into clinical research. No, they are overlapping. They are interdigitating. On the contrary, they complete each other in their realistic essence. But here, the compulsions of the situation mandated, I don't say, if either we call them permissible deviations, I have nothing to say. But today, when I look dispassionately, these are the two documents and these are the operations. Operations and the documents, the operation at areas seems to be inconsistent with the documents that are there. It is not a conflict. We can justify in the name of compulsion, but whether should this compulsion also not make us believe and alert us that is there a need of, in the contingent situations, can there be certain permissible modifications which can be done into the governing ethics could be a good solution.
On the vaccine trials, I was actually one of the volunteers in England for the AstraZeneca, and many of my colleagues in PGH and Digger and Ames Delhi were also. In the vaccine trials, unless there's a spectrum not only of socio-educational economic spectrum, but of genotype and racial spectrums. Like, you know, from the American vaccine trials, we need to have enough Hispanic and Black Americans as much balanced with the white Americans to prove the vaccine efficiency. And there were discussions over there as well as to whether there was equal representation. Unless the vaccine manufacturers are subjected to proof that they have tested a significant number of the world population to reflect the genotype, not only the economic, you know, strata, how will that vaccine be ever relevant when it's a pan-global problem? So your thoughts on that, unless you put regulation on the companies that are manufacturing it, it'll always be a Russian vaccine or a Chinese vaccine or an Indian vaccine or AstraZeneca, which is English, you know, UK vaccine.
That was the reason why I was saying was, why did we come to the principle of equipoise? 1962, when we not at this particular, if we really look into the memoirs in regard to the discussion and debate which ultimately resulted in generation of the principle of equipoise, we said the moment the first effective vaccine will be coming to the knowledge, then all parallel trials and all parallel situations, they will come to a standstill, because it would be futile for you to be putting various subjects to otherwise avoidable trials, and then the concentration will be on the same for the purposes of working out. And that is the reason you name prior to COVID-19 that we have multiplicity of vaccines on any given situation. None. It is here, and that was the reason why, as long as the principle of equipoise is in operation, how is it that what is being worked out in the present context would be said to be permissible? It is totally a breach of principle of equipoise. Either we do away with the principle of equipoise, or if the principle of equipoise is in operation, then whatever we are putting into reality perhaps is inconsistent with what we have worked out for ourselves. And that is the contradiction.
And if I may come, one last question, Dr. Desai, if I'm permitted.
Sir,
shall I give way?
Okay.
We can take
you later on.
Fine. Thank you. Yeah.
Dr. Joseph wants to ask. Yes, Dr. Joseph. Sir, you have to unmute. You have to unmute, sir. Dr. Joseph, you need to unmute.
Yeah, I'm trying to. Okay. Good evening, sir. Thank you for that wonderful lecture. My question is, on one side, we talk about progress of science, acquiring new knowledge and new inventions. Now, in the era of informed consent, where participant has the right either to take part or not to, how did the secondary vaccine trials lure these participants into their trials? And what did the authorities or monitoring agency did regarding this?
I would not be in a position to say with certainty as to what exactly the monitoring agencies did. But that is the reason when I am advocating, when Dr. Mona asked me what is the solution, I said a white paper thereof. What is a white paper? White paper will bring all these situations into reality. I mean, the relevant details that as to whether the money which is paid to me for the purposes of participation into the human challenge trial, was it an inducement or not, is first question which will be required to be answering. Whether this particular, and that is the reason why three issues I have raised. Number one, is it an accident that people by and large who have been participant into the human challenge trial as subjects belong to poor socioeconomic criteria? One. Number two, it is not only that, the money which was payable was good enough for them in the present context of socioeconomic malady that they have been put into. Two. And number three, the economic recession, which is a severe threat. Imagine if the high class of the society is threatened with the economic recession, then the weakest one is absolutely inundated. So these are the compulsions which make you literally sign an informed consent in letter, but your compulsions in spirit are compelling you to be signing that informed consent. And that is exactly, the socio-demographic differentiation of the participants permissible in the challenge will be the one which will be a factor which will bring the picture categorically.
Sir, one more thing I would like to add, that it is a very sad affair that so many of our patients who have in the trials are not given vaccine certificates. Though they have been given two doses, they are not given vaccination certificates. So this is a very sad affair. So I think some agency or government has to take care of all those things. I think so, but we can't do anything about it. Yes. Yes, Dr. Joseph. Sir, unmute, please. Dr. Joseph.
Sir, this is regarding the trials involving placebo.
Yeah.
In this emergent situation, is a vaccine trial with placebo justified? If yes, how do you justify it? And if not, why?
Look, placebo trials have been put across invariably into the guidelines which we have worked for generation of any vaccination. If you look at the generic guidelines put across by WHO, in as recent as 2009 H1N1 vaccination that we put one into public domain, it is placebo trial was declared to be a must, and the justification was because the larger sample size and the larger recruitment which otherwise is relevant to the global usage will be worked out through placebo trials only. And therefore, it is in that context that this has been undertaken. Now, here the issue is when we are wanting to be working out with minimized recruitment of the volunteers, then perhaps the operational modality in terms of the traditional modality is different. And it is in that context, a compromised plasmo trial turns out to be an operational reality. But whenever we talk of a vaccination, which is expected to be nearly having a universal usage, plasmo trial turns out to be an inevitable necessity towards certification of the same.
But that is harming the vulnerable group. You are denying somebody who deserves that vaccine unless there is clinical or therapeutic equipoise, if you are not sure what it is.
Look, ultimately, it is a balancing between human challenge trial and plasmo trials, and that is the reason they have to be put across together for the purposes of decipherance of conclusion. They isolatedly, it will not be able to counterbalance. But when we are putting the two together, the equipoise is balanced.
Thank you, sir.
Fortunately, we now have our national president with us, Dr. J. Jailal, sir. Sir, welcome, and would you like to address the meet?
Thank you, sir. But you were talking
yes,
today.
Yes, sir. Namaskar, sir. Ved Prakash, sir. Namaskar.
Thank you very much, sir. And this is a very important meeting which we are carrying on, Dr. K.K. Agarwal's legacy. And most importantly, we are waiting for Dr. our Ved Prakash, the fifth Veda of our medical profession, to address. He was so busy and he couldn't get his earlier days. So today, it was fortunate he was able to be with us and talk on the vaccine and how to choose and various issues related to that. It is always a pleasure to listen to Dr. Ved Prakash, Mr. It is any topic, and his wisdom and the way he puts in, the way he was able to infect his ideas to for any person who is able to come in contact with that, is much more virulent than Delta Plus. it is a gift of God for Indian Medical Association to have access to high-end people like Professor Dr. Ved Prakash Misraji. So it is with a great gratitude, we salute you for the time spending for us. It is our dream, this K.K. Agarwal, Padmashri K.K. Agarwal legacy and his vision and passion for continuing medical education to be continued. So we have committed for that, and we will try to take it forward to the longer phase. So we are also happy today we are together with Mona Desai Madam in Surat, and we are held up here in a meeting. So thank you for Mona Desai Madam for traveling all the way from Ahmedabad to come to Surat and still finding time to be with and very well, with effectively moderating this session. Thanks a lot. Looking forward to have more such sessions in the future.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, National President, sir. Would you like to add something?
Yeah. Thank you, Ved Prakash, sir, for enlightening us on the various issues of vaccine, especially ethical issues, what you have put it. And definitely, I must really understand those issues, because nowadays many patients come and ask us what to do and what, especially those who are traveling abroad. They have a lot of difficulties because these two vaccines, you know, sometimes they may get stuck across. So really, it was good to listen to us. Unfortunately, we were held up in another meeting, so we couldn't join to beginning. But at the end, we said we will definitely join in. Thank you, Dr. Mona, for moderating this session and helping us out. And definitely, this entire lecture, sir, will be available on our website as well as in our YouTube platform. Immediately, once it is uploaded, we'll give the link. And more and more doctors can listen to it at a later convenient date. And on the website, I have created now one current event wherein all these lectures one by one will appear in a, uploaded. So anytime you go to that place, all the lectures will be available and will be visible. So once again, thank you for joining and helping us out. Thank you, Ved Prakash, sir, and thank you, Mona Desai. More to you, Mona Madam. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Sir, our president, sir, was very right. You are so cognizant and you are so, like, any topic we give you, and you are just superb. So in the real sense, you are a professor, and this is what we expect, sir. So I think this is just for you, Professor Ved Prakash Mishra, sir. You are perfect. And thank you so much. I think Professor Partha wanted to ask one more question. We'll just take the last one and then we'll wrap up this talk. Yes, Professor Partha.
Yeah, thank you, madam. Yes, Professor Mishra, since the Delta variant, thanks, Professor Mishra. Since the Delta variant was mentioned, and at this point of time across the whole world, all the vaccine technology is geared on the original variant, Alpha variant or the Kent variant. But we have been rolling out only the original variant, hoping it will work against the other variants, like the Delta variant. And as I was listening to the lecture, there is some cross-protection, but the exact seroconversion rate or the protection rate is not very clear. So again, from an ethical perspective, as a doctor speaking to my patients, am I giving them the right confidence in believing that, you know, AstraZeneca will give them 60%, Covaxin will give them 70%? You know, there's a full spectrum of responsiveness. Not all of them are equally effective against the Alpha variant. So when they ask me about the Delta variant, I'm basically sort of, you know, not speaking to them from evidence or truth. What shall I do? Your comments, sir.
The fact of the story, really speaking, there is no evidence available. So therefore, to say that we will be able to make any statement on this with an evidence is an apology, because there is no evidence. In absence of an evidence, it will be only a corollary of evidence, and corollary of evidence will be generic in character. Circumstantially speaking, normally the nature that we are talking about, core initiation of cellular immunity, therefore, it should be in a position to take care of. But then specifically when it comes to humoral immunity, it will not. So therefore, I mean, if you look into these aspects, unless we will be generating evidence, we will not be having one. The fact of the story is, any variant, in case of any vaccination at any point of time, it takes quite time for you to be generating evidence on that count. It cannot be by experience. And even if it is by experience, it is only empirical evidence. It is not a clinching evidence. Therefore, to say that any assurance or any interpretation can be made on this count, I think, is only empirical in character and not evidence-based.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Namaste. Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Ved Prakash, sir. Sir, you have spared time for us for this. And I think it is a real tribute to our late Padma Shri Dr. K.K. Agrawal, sir. We really miss him and all his lectures. But sir, I think you should come very regularly and give this kind of talks so that we are getting the advantage of it. Once again, thank you so much. And thanks to all the listeners and all the viewers. And I hope you all have learned so many things out of it. Thank you once again and have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you, Mona. God bless you. Bye-bye.